Do you ever feel like you just can't stop thinking about food to the point it becomes a distraction? You can't focus on work or keep a thought in your head that doesn't center around the next thing you eat? Researchers call these intrusive thoughts food noise. And for some people, food noise can make it hard to understand their own hunger and fullness signals. This can lead to compulsive eating, overeating, and sometimes obesity. Researchers who study obesity believe understanding food noise is crucial. In fact, patients taking weight loss drugs like Ozempic and Zepbound, which are some of the most effective weight loss treatments available, often report their food noise was diminished or gone entirely within hours of starting the medication. Stuart B. Murray is the director of the Eating Disorders Program at UCLA's Semmel Institute for Neuroscience and Human Behavior. I recently chatted with him about his research on food noise, what triggers it, how it relates to obesity, GLP-1 weight loss drugs, and more. Here's our conversation.
You know, just for starters, could you just explain what people mean when they say food noise?
Food noise refers to sort of cognitive noise and this sort of perseverative, repetitive craving of food, or these persistent thoughts about food and sort of anticipation of what food might taste like, what food is going to be pleasant, that can feel quite intrusive. So we refer to that as sort of a cognitive noise.
How does, the concept of food noise, how does this relate to obesity?
It does relate to obesity. You can sort of consider or conceptualize food noise as this repetitive, recurring thoughts about food, planning food, anticipating how food would taste, or anticipating a hedonic experience of food consumption. And this hedonic experience, or this anticipatory hedonic experience, does predict food consumption. And usually food noise is geared towards the most palatable foods, which are oftentimes the most high sugar, ultra-processed foods that we know are linked to obesity. So there's not a causal link, but we know that the more food noise a person is reporting, the more hedonic anticipation people have of food consumption, the more likely a person is to consume food, and the more frequently you consume high-fat foods, you may see some change in your weight.
And hedonic is as in like hedonism, is that right?
Kind of yes, like, yes, like, yeah.
So, GLP-1 drugs, these blockbuster drugs, right? Like Ozempic, Zepbound, Wegovy, they're thought to decrease this food noise, right? Is that what we're seeing?
Yeah, we are seeing a reduction in the anticipatory pleasure to be derived from food. We're seeing that manifest all the way through to weight loss. So people on those GLP-1 agonists are reporting a reduction in food noise, a reduction in craving, a reduction in food consumption, and a reduction in body weight. I think the key is that we're not entirely sure yet at the level of the brain how these medications work specifically, and how we can optimize those mechanisms in people that aren't maybe benefiting in the same way as other people taking the same class of medication. That's very much the next step in this line of research, but certainly there's a lot of preliminary evidence now showing that food noise is reduced in concert with GLP-1 medications.
These GLP-1 drugs also, right, they have like a physical component. Insofar as they slow digestion or gastric emptying, is the effect in the brain that you're seeing, is it related to the gastrointestinal effect, or is it kind of a coincidence that it also works in the brain? I'm kind of curious about how those two things are related, if they're related or at all.
Yeah, I think some of the challenges now is that we're taking anecdotal reports from patients, and I'm reluctant to put the cart before the horse, so to speak. I think that there are a multitude of effects of these medications. Whether they're causally related is less clear. I think intuitively it makes sense. I think if someone's feeling more full, they're less likely, there's a reduced drive to go eat. That intuitively makes sense.
At least how it's understood so far, right, is that insofar as they do work in the brain, they work in the reward centers of the brain, right? I'm curious, is it possible in a similar effect, could the negative impact reward for, ostensibly healthy things like, hobbies or exercise or sex or things that the reward center also operates on?
Potentially. That's a really excellent question. We know, though, that in this instance, so when we talk about reward learning, we talk about dopamine. Dopamine is the neurotransmitter that's sort of released when something good happens and it makes us feel pleasant. And what can happen with food consumption in particular, we can get a strong anticipatory sort of receptor availability when you're anticipating food. That's actually primed more when we're hungry. which is actually why flash diets don't work for the most part. When you restrict your food pervasively, there's an evolutionary process that essentially makes our dopaminergic receptors more available, meaning that when we're more hungry, we're more likely to experience a really positive effect of food consumption. I'm sure many of us can identify with that. I live in LA. I missed my turn off on the freeway the other day. I got home an hour later and then I took a bite of my apple and I was like, oh my gosh, this is the best apple I've ever had in my life because I had this flood of dopamine. And so we know that food restriction primes that pathway much more than abstinence from sex would, for instance. So your question is a good one, but I think it's more pronounced in the context of food because food restriction primes that pathway more than other hedonic pursuits would. And that goes back to our own evolution, right? If you think when we were cavemen and women and we're risking predation and you're getting more and more hungry, you're more likely to make risky decisions to go out and pursue food because you have this dopaminergic risk-taking impulsive pathway that's more ready to act to keep you alive, basically. And the people that erred on the side of caution probably didn't find food and didn't pass on their genes. So the way that we're wired now is the more we restrict our food, the more likely we are to make impulsive decisions in the pursuit of pleasures, in this case, food.
How about for, you know, decidedly less healthy things like drugs and alcohol? I know there's been some research into that area. Just seeing what you've been seeing as goes for, you know, an alcohol craving or a nicotine craving.
Great question. We're seeing some preliminary evidence for other hedonic impulsive behaviors as well. So you're right. These drugs we know impact the reward circuit, which starts in the midbrain and projects through this mesolimbic dopamine pathway to other parts of the brain that respond when something good happens. And that something good can be actually bad for you, like you're mentioning here with substance misuse. We're seeing some preliminary effects of that, but I think this is anecdotal. And how this evidence base came about were people who were prescribed these medications for weight loss, reporting to their physician, hey, I notice that I'm smoking much less, or hey, I notice that my craving for this substance or that substance is starting to dwindle a little bit as well. So now I think our challenge is going to take this anecdotal evidence and really looking at this in a systematic way to understand whether other implications of modifying the reward circuit are indeed happening, or some of these are placebo. We don't know yet.
Yeah. And could you just describe some of your research? I mean, just like what are some of the ways that you're studying this, how you go about your work?
Yeah, so my research really focuses on food noise in the context of binge eating disorder, which is the most common eating disorder phenotype with a lifetime prevalence now of more than 5%. Binge eating disorder is highly linked with overweight and obesity as well. So they're not one and the same, but there's quite a lot of overlap. And binge eating disorder is characterized by frequent episodes of loss of control eating that culminates in eating a large amount of food in a relatively short period of time. And really what my research now is trying to look at is whether there are biological vulnerabilities to binge eating disorder or binge eating behaviors. And we've just undertaken the first brain assessment of children that are as young as 9. And we found that even by age 9, kids that show binge eating proclivities have brains that are structurally different and are functionally different. So the way that their brains are wired are different and the way that they're built is different. And they seem to converge in two circuits. One is the reward circuit that we've alluded to. And the other is the inhibitory control circuit, which is the ability to sort of put the brakes on the reward pathway and sort of stifle urges or cravings. And we see dysregulation between those two circuits, which is almost the perfect storm of the development of binge eating disorder. You have this heightened reward circuit with sort of sensitivities, and you have a blunted inhibitory control circuit. So it's hard to put the brakes on as well. That's what we're finding. I'm very interested in taking some of the medications that we know do have weight loss properties to see whether they can affect binge eating as a behavior and not just as a cardinal outcome being the weight. The only FDA approved medication for binge eating disorder is lisdexamfetamine or Vyvanse. And it doesn't really have that much effect on weight per se. Mm-hmm. So there's a really vast expanse here to think about how can we help kids that are binge eating, both in terms of their eating behavior, but in terms of their metabolic biomarkers as well. These markers of prediabetes are really, really critical to address.
Yeah.
That's where my research is going.
Is that almost, is it like almost a one-to-one correlation with being overweight or obese, or do some people have binge eating and don't become overweight or obese?
Yeah, so obesity and overweight is, there's a strong genetic underpinning of that, but of course there are lifestyle factors that impact that as well.
Sure.
And so I think those with binge eating disorder will have a nine-fold greater risk of being overweight or obese. And those with obesity will have a six-fold greater risk of having binge eating behaviors. Mm-hmm. So there's a huge degree of overlap. I just don't want to conflate those terms.
Sure, I know. Right. The only reason I ask is just because it seems to me just like, you know, if you're treating someone for binge eating with the GLP-1, for example, you know, would it be like something to be preventative? Like you see someone that has a pattern of binge eating, or does binge eating usually get kind of diagnosed or observed after someone is already overweight or obese? Like, I'm just kind of curious to like the, which comes first, because as far as using GLP-1s, it can be used to be treated obesity, right? So mm-hmm. like, I was curious to how it would be, when it would be put in place to treat binge eating, if that makes sense.
Yeah, I think that's a really good question. We're actually in the midst of getting some really controlled, large-scale controlled trials on deck now. And one of the interventions I'm most interested in is Contrave, which has known effects for the cessation of other impulsive behaviors like smoking, other potentially addictive behaviors as well. And we know it has an effect on weight as well. So there's this new medication that has an effect on weight, and it has a known effect on other potentially impulsive behaviors. We think that might be, maybe it's too soon to say that could be a game changer, but we're really interested to explore the effect of that medication in the context of overweight and obesity, in the context of those who binge eat. It's sort of been a really big elephant in the room. I think a lot of times these medications don't assess eating behaviors. They're treating overweight and obesity glibly without assessing whether their patients have or do not have eating disordered behavior. And if they do, you really have to address that in those patients in terms of their long-term wellness. That has to be a really core part of treatment.